Well, we could talk about. But should we? That's the question. That's the question. Been very feisty today because, just that the having been marginalized, it's anyone who believed in unidentified aerial phenomena, you are unidentified flying objects, was labeled a nutcase, crazy person, someone you don't want to talk to, stay away from this person, they're crazy, that kind of thing. That's what the government said. This is what the government want everyone to believe. And it's just a matter if you're really smart, you can see a lot more of what's going on in this world than the government wants you to talk about or to know about or anything like that. The government loves people to be stupid because that helps them govern you or control you, as you might say. Governance, of course, is a certain amount of control involved in governance. And the people who get used to being the bureaucrats of governance, they want to keep their positions, of course. So they want to do everything they can to control the populace. Now, in a democracy, we were supposed to avoid the evils of governance, but we didn't, actually. We really didn't. There's still a massive social level of bureaucracy involved, career politicians involved, etc. The idea that we're supposed to, change a president every elections is you keep cleaning out these people who want to overextend government. That's the whole point of the United States of America, is limit the federal government, give authority to states and counties and cities, etc., spread the authority out instead of focusing it on the federal government. So you focus on too much on the federal government and all the big grants, all the money that's flowing, and they want it to keep flowing, and so they want the same people in government that keep the money flowing, okay? So it's a military-industrial complex, shadow government, bureaucracy, all this stuff, Washington, they call it. That's where all the money comes from. And so they want to make sure that their people are in the right place to keep that money flowing. So it's not been a very good experiment, democracy in the United States. They're basically they call it, they're always telling, hey, great democracy, all this blah blah blah, but actually it's been extremely exploited, and it hasn't been great, and it's been a big failure actually. But they virtue signal, how great it is all the time. A virtue signal, like, yeah, everything's, so done so perfectly here and so great. And it's not true at all. It's not true at all. It's dressing up what they're doing and hiding behind the virtue of democracy, claiming that in a democracy everything must be totally legit and honest and moral and ethical and all this kind of stuff. Utter nonsense. Utter nonsense. This democracy here is been smoke and mirrors. I mean, Franklin Roosevelt was paralyzed in a wheelchair. Nobody even knew that. Nobody even knew it. They hid it. And how long was he in office? Like 3 terms or something? Nobody, the people didn't even know. And who was running the government? Well, partly him, but a lot of other people, and his wife had a lot to do with it also. But could you imagine that this was kept hidden from the public? The guy was in a wheelchair, and nobody ever knew it, and most people still don't even know it. What kind of democracy is that? Then John F. Kennedy, for instance, was extremely sickly boy, young man. And then he got that terrible PT boat accident. It was an extreme pain, painkillers. He was on so much medication, even as when he was a youngster. He had so many illnesses and sicknesses. He was a super sickly person. And then the back injury, he was on intense meds for that. And then they were shooting him up with so many medications, including massive amounts of amphetamines. Every time you saw Kennedy on television, etc., he was high as a kite. But he was focused, and he was dynamic, and he was in charge, because that's amphetamines. That's amphetamines. It was all fake. It was all fake. And then he'd go home and he'd collapse in bed for weeks. He couldn't even function. They had to cover the whole thing up. The whole Camelot thing was just a drug gang, essentially. And that was broadcast to the world. This whole gang was on drugs. This whole circle of people are on drugs, including the doctors and everybody else. That was projected to the world as like, this is the greatest country in the world, got the greatest leadership in the world, this blah, 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 blah. I mean, it's been smoke and mirrors, this whole thing. And now it's 10 times worse than it ever was. 10 times worse than it ever was, and even beyond that. So we have this entrenched, sort of a system of career, you know, even generational kind of people involved in making sure the money flows certain places here and there. It's like an aristocracy, even the bureaucracy in a lot of ways. And then you have all the people feeding off of that, massive amounts of money going to them. Then, you know, so they have interest in keeping policy a certain way. So, you know, what happens when they run into... And they say, hey, we can make a lot of money off this, actually. Okay, so let's get the word out to our partners here in crime that keep it quiet. We don't want our competitors getting this information. So a lot of competition. Let's say they're reverse engineering some technology that came into their hands. Well, you know, you can understand that they feel it's very proprietary, both on a business scale and a country scale, but the country really is just their money flow. Okay, their money flow, their power and money flow. It just makes it possible. USA made that possible, and then other countries have their money flow. So they would tell the government, "Don't say anything. Don't say anything. We don't want anyone to know, because you know maybe some competition will come up or something like that. So I mean, a lot of people think Kennedy was assassinated because he was going to blow the whistle on all of this stuff, and he probably was. That's probably very likely. Because Eisenhower knew about, okay, absolutely. And he warned the world. He called it military-industrial complex. His folks, he says, you got a big, big problem. You're in extreme danger here in the world. People say, what are you talking about? That was his parting speech. What's this guy talking about? Is he crazy or something? He made it seem like there was some extreme conspiracy danger to the world. And he called it the military-industrial complex. Those are private companies we're talking about. And what he was really talking about was the military-industrial complex and their interrelationship with, yeah. So that's been going on for like 70 years or more. Okay, 70 years or so, yeah. We'll call it 70. That's a nice round number. You know, what they don't tell us is just as instructive as what they do tell us. So now they're saying, oh, yeah, we got some tic-tacs out there. We got some unidentified aerial phenomena out there. And they're playing chicken with our F-15s. The Navy, you'll say, yeah, they're buzzing our jet fighters. And they're getting in games with our jet fighters and doing all this funny stuff, and like it's really interesting. I don't know what's going on with it. And so now they're saying, oh yeah, they've been showing up at our military bases every single day for years and years and years, and just doing all sorts of crazy maneuvers, and like I guess they just love hijinks, you know, just kind of like have for fun, like playing. It's like gay playing. They're just having fun, I guess, that, you know. And so we're supposed to believe that that's all that they're here for. That's it, nothing more. They just kind of came here to like hang out with the jet fighters and like say, huh, what kind of aerial phenomena? Maybe they're checking out unidentified aerial phenomena. Like, you know, what are these funny jet planes? What are those anyway? Yeah, sure, that's the only reason why they're here. Right. Absolutely. or maybe they're just pilotless things, and who knows what they are? There's nothing else involved. I mean, so what they're not saying is extremely instructive. Okay, sure, it's been around, and they've been around throughout history because ancient paintings have the same craft in their paintings. So people saw stuff and they painted it in, say, hey, this is what we're seeing in the sky. 500 years ago, 1,000 years ago, 2,000 years ago, these things have been seen. They're unidentified aerial phenomena have been seen. And now that, but they're very intelligent and, you know, and very agile and can go through the ocean real fast and do all this stuff. But they're just, what, they're just hanging out here. They might be here for more reasons than just for kicks. Like what? Like what? Social engineering, maybe. Like what? Maybe they have some issue. Maybe they have a reason for being here. Maybe they have a reason for being here. Yeah. And we might guess what that might be. Now, a lot of people already know what it is. All this information came out long, long ago, if you are paying attention. But there's a whole group of people came into the world who weren't really very interested in that stuff for some reason. Like collusionists, you might say, who just collusionists, or millennial collusionists, you might call them, that are part of the whole thing, actually. They're part of the whole thing. Well, why? So why is here? Why? What's going on here? Well, the most obvious answer would be hybridization program. Oh yeah, they want to create a new race. It's called, that's what we call the new age. The new age is actually the age of and human hybrids. Yes. Now, in order to get to that age, what do they need to do? Maybe is to populate. So, this is why these times feel so weird, right? Everyone I talk with says these times are real weird. I talked to a guy who's weird. He loves weirdness. His whole life is weirdness. He thinks he has to escape underground and live underground for a period of time. And I asked him, is it weird enough for you? He goes, it's too weird. It's too weird. He's freaked out. It's so weird. I said, oh, wow. If he's freaked out, you know, wow, that's an eye opener. So people, everybody feels like, what in the heck is going on? Like Karl Marx, you know, he'd say, this is, what are you guys doing? This has nothing to do with what I want. People keep saying, well, it's Marxism, it's socialism, you know, it's communism. No, it's not. It's a bizarre hybrid, including, yeah, it's a bizarre hybrid. So there is this, as the story goes, the decision to have a hybridization program take place in this world. That was the decision. And so that has been worked on for quite some time here, 70 years. And permission was given in exchange for technology given to certain countries that they would be allowed to conduct hybridization experiments. And that's been going on for a long time. So a lot of millennials are actually hybrids in a psychological way, in a certain way. They're psychological. Part of it is a psychological thing, actually. Their psyche is aligned with the overall hybridization program. So they've been primed for that. And they make the cut, you know, into the new age. The new age. And so why is doing this? Well, they got a lot of issues. One of them is that they've developed in a certain direction to such an extreme extent that they're extremely imbalanced. They've reached some sort of psychological dead end. They've dead-ended in a horrific way, and they're desperate for emotion, emotion, the stuff that humans have. They're desperate for that. They feel that their survival is dependent upon it. So, but they don't want to give up their, you know, tech focus, you might say, either. So they want to try to combine the two. And that's their thing. And they feel that this new hybrid race will be like a perfect race. You know, this is the, you heard where we heard that before, creating a perfect humanity, a super race. That started when? Well, late 1930s in Germany. So, if you're feeling like the world is just something that just doesn't add up here in the world, if you're feeling that way, well, try factoring in, okay, and suddenly you'll say, hey, maybe I'm starting to make sense what's going on here, actually. Maybe. Maybe. Yeah. So with that said, you know, what do we do? What do we do? So this is really important information, actually, because people have been thinking like, well, maybe we can, you know, trying to use history as a way to figure out, you know, to go forward. But it's not working very well, is it? It's not working very well. We're thinking like, you know, what do we do? Nothing seems to work. You know, it's really tough. Well, now we know why, because we hadn't been factoring in a very important element of what's been going on in this world. Big deals have been made, to say the least. So, what do we do going forward? Well, we need to rely upon that, which is quite superior to. Quite superior. Otherwise, we're going to be in big trouble. And so what is superior? Well, the great spiritual coaches are superior, to say the least. Yeah. And we need to fast forward them right into our lives right here, right now, at this point. Let's fast forward Ramaharshi to right now with what's going on in the world, actually. And get some updated responses, so to speak. That needs to happen. We need to rely upon perfect immunity to what's going on in the world. Perfect immunity, because these folks have an agenda. Has an agenda, to say the least. And the agenda is not so kind to humanity, you might say. But they say, well, humanity has reached a dead end. And so have we. But if you combine the two, it'll be go on to a glorious future. You know, like that kind of thing. Yeah. So what we need to do is we need to rely upon the great spiritual coaches, those who realize that this whole universe is just our own dream, as Ramana Maharshi puts it so well. God, soul, and world are all just a dream. It's just a dream. It's just our imagination. Above that, intrinsic, what is true is not intrinsic at all. What is truly intrinsic is the great perfection, the great self. So this whole universe is just a conceptualization, you might say. But what we really say here is it's a scheme of disempowerment, actually. It's a scheme of disempowerment. So if you got a group of who believe that they're smart enough, you know, to what? Come up with what? That they're going to find something that's able to disempower the prime creator and that this whole scheme's going to work? No, it's not. It's not. So they may be way dumber than they even believe. They admit that they've really run into a dead end. Well, they may not be aware. They're not aware of just how unaware they are. That's actually true. The humility is not their strong suit. to say the least, to say the least. So this whole scheme of disempowerment doesn't work. The mind can't cure the mind. The mind cannot cure the mind, okay? Only grace can cure the mind, and it doesn't cure it, it transcends it. It transcends it. There is no cure for insanity. There's only a transcending of insanity, or an intrinsicking of insanity, I would say is a better term. We go intrinsic instead of insane. Insanity is insanity. There's no way to fix it. Insanity is denial of intrinsic. So you can't have a denial of intrinsic without being insane. That's impossible. That's impossible. The only cure for insanity is to accept what is intrinsic. That's the only cure there is. And our friend doesn't have that cure for us. They have a hybridization program. You know, let's mingle these different forces and different things, and let's tweak this and let's try this, and we think we can make it work, and we've got the right medications and drugs to make it work, and you know, blah, 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 blah. And the right technology. We're all teched up, and you guys are all emotional. It's great. Let's mix the two and see what happens. Kind of a Frankensteinian situation. More than kind of. So they don't know. The only cure for the insanity of disempowerment, the belief in disempowerment, is insane. The only cure for insanity is intrinsicness. Intrinsicness is what is. It's not caused. It's what is. It's not the result of any causation whatsoever. It's not the result of any causation whatsoever. Now, these folks they're just messed up like we are. They're different styles of being, you know, of exploring disempowerment. So they listen. They listen. You can relate. You can converse. You can, you know, it's just like anything else. If you have respect for them, they have respect for you, etc. But that doesn't mean they know the answer. They're still trying to fix, you know, they're trying to fix disempowerment. There's no fix for it. There's no fix for it. You got to relinquish it and experience intrinsicness. What is intrinsic? Intrinsicness doesn't come about through any result. You don't get intrinsicness by fixing disempowerment. You don't get it that way. So the mind, it keeps trying to fix everything. It says, oh, don't worry, I'll fix this. Well, that's saying that there isn't intrinsicness. If there was intrinsicness, what are we doing trying to fix something? You see how that works? So the only answer is to accept intrinsicness as it is, not as a result of us fixing something. So you got the same old, same old, same old. When we're talking about, you know, we got the same old, same old, same old going on. It's nothing. We got so much technology, how to fix so many things. We'll fix this, we'll fix this, we'll fix this, we'll fix this. Well, that's talking about a dream of disempowerment. You don't get free of a dream of disempowerment by working on fixing various aspects of it. That's insanity. You don't fix insanity by trying to fix insanity. You accept intrinsicness is the only remedy there is. It's the only remedy there is. You don't fix insanity by trying to fix insanity. That's a funny way to put it. It's a nice way to put it. I took a walk like 2 days ago, I think. I went to bed and I was trashed. I woke up, I was trashed. I couldn't sleep. My legs, my body was so trashed. I've never felt so trashed in my life. Holy cow, I didn't think I even could even get out of bed in the morning. Somehow I made it through yesterday and then today, feeling a little better. But holy cow, I can't believe how, you know, what this, you know, what happened to my body with this illness is just, I couldn't believe it. I was in super shape before I got sick. I was in great shape. I was power walking up, 70 flights of stairs, so to speak, just they pulse up to 170 plus and feeling great. And now I go on a walk, which is some gentle hills and stuff, and I'm almost dead. I mean, what's going on with that? I've taken Tylenol the last couple of days just to survive from, I feel how terrible I feel, from just any exertion at all. It's scary. But the exertion right here is to help people recognize what's going on and say, hey, check themselves, say, wait a minute. Trying to fix stuff, is that the answer? Reality's perfect. There's no such thing as fixing anything in reality. It doesn't exist at all and never will. So what are we doing trying to fix stuff? Where did the imperfect come from? It came from our desire to be prime creator, and therefore we needed to somehow displace the prime creator. I mean, it's a little more complicated than that, because when we had the desire to become prime creator, we couldn't experience that idea. That idea felt disempowered to us, and then we felt, oh, the prime creator somehow became disempowered because it can't give us this experience. We got to fix disempowerment then. Okay, so here we are in this world trying to fix disempowerment, but also we feel like, hey, maybe there's no way to fix disempowerment, so we have to somehow find a way to disempower the prime creator so it quits. We have to find a way to make it quit. And this is the guilt. We're trying to lay guilt trip on the prime creator. Like, look at all the suffering we got going here. Or we're trying to disempowerment to power it to such a total extent, such an extreme extent, that we're able to somehow displace it or take over. So this is why you have in existence, this dream of existence, all these takeovers are always happening and disempowerment's happening and stuff. That's just all part of the scheme of how do we get to be prime creator? Well, the answer is we don't. Intrinsic can't be prior to itself. What reality is intrinsic. Intrinsic cannot be prior to intrinsic. There is no possibility of that. Otherwise, it wouldn't be intrinsic in the first place. I mean, this is obviously self-evident, but it's worth emphasizing here. So we're doing okay with this video. I've been, again, so hyped up and feisty today just because I feel everything is coming to this point right now where people really have to make a decision what's going to go on. Are we going to try to make the cut, and get into the new age and be part of this great, hybridization program and experiment and all this kind of stuff? And, it's just, wow. You see people taking so many... transitioning in so many different ways, right? Well, that's just the tip of the iceberg of the transitioning that will be taking place going forward. People will be transitioning into a hybrid type of person, and you see that with the artificial intelligence and neurosync, and the idea of like trying to fix this universe, explore this universe and stuff. Nothing is stupider than exploring this universe. That's the stupidest thing imaginable. What are we exploring? Disempowerment, Different. Let's go study other areas of, issues in the universe. Oh, a supernova. So a star became disempowered and it's now dissipated. Oh, that's so interesting. Blah, 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 blah. So the stupidest people in the world are those who are really into exploring the universe. That's a sign of extreme stupidity. We need to relinquish this universe. It's a dream scheme of disempowerment, which has no effect on reality and diverts our attention away from reality, which is our true home, which is entirely intrinsic, is perfect, is flawless. We love it. And yet here we are exploring a dream of disempowerment. How smart is that? It's not very smart. So you have these people in the world who are big rock star idols, and their whole thing is, we need to go to Mars, that thing kind of stuff. That's like beyond stupid. That's the stupidest thing possible. We don't need to go anywhere. We don't need to go anywhere, except they call it going within, but it's really going with intrinsicness. Do we need to breathe in reality? No. It's like, could you imagine reality where you if you have to breathe, and if you don't breathe, you die? How utterly absurd is that? Is what we are, which is formless freedom, and creativity-ing, effortless, ceaseless, creative freedoming. Doesn't need to breathe, doesn't need to eat, doesn't have any needs at all. There's no such thing as needs in reality. If you're talking about needs, you're talking about a dream of disempowerment. Why do we need to study a dream of disempowerment? What good does that do us, actually? What? That's for morons, the study of dream of disempowerment. Yeah. That's called wasting your time. That's called a slow boat. That's called trying to swim across the ocean. I mean, that's called going real, real, real slow. A slow boat to nowhere. So you have this huge group of people in the world right now, we call them millennials if you want, who want to go through another cycle of existence, of this aimless studying disempowerment. For what end? To fix it? To fix it? There's nothing in reality that needs fixing. So again, when we chose this idea of trying to be prime creator, trying to be prior to intrinsicness, that idea had no creative flow to it. It felt disempowered. And it's the first time we've ever felt that, because all our ideas are perfectly empowered, and we experience them beautifully and flawlessly, spontaneously. But this idea of trying to be prior to intrinsicness didn't have that. And we felt, there's some disempowerment. What is this? What's happening? We need to figure this out. We need to study this. But there was no disempowerment. The idea of intrinsicness being prior to itself is just absurdity. It's absurdity. It's the idea of absurdity. And we should just have laughed at it. Okay, the only empowerment this idea has is laughter. We should have laughed at the idea and then dropped it. Instead, we forgot the laugh, so then we took it seriously, and then we had this whole dream of disempowerment, utilizing it in several different ways, but basically, we're trying to figure out, how do we fix disempowerment, and if we can't, how do we disempower the prime creator totally, so we can be prime creator, and then reality will be truly empowered. We can experience any idea we want to, including the idea of being prior to intrinsicness. So that's the only problem we have. We don't need to be studying the universe and studying anything at all in this universe at all. We don't need any of that. It's totally unnecessary. Totally unnecessary. It's no purpose to it whatsoever. Reality is not disempowered or flawed in any way. Not in any way. Again, the mistake we made when we chose the idea of being prior to intrinsicness is that we felt we didn't experience it. We said, what's happening? There's something wrong with the prime creator. It's disempowered. That was the mistake. Instead of laughing at this absurdity, we took it seriously. Then we mistakenly believed the prime creator is defective. It became disempowered somehow. We figured we got to fix this. We got to heal this. We got to heal the prime creator or get rid of the prime creator. And so, but that's totally untrue. So this whole dream of disempowerment is completely unnecessary. It's completely unnecessary. And I have zero interest in studying the universe. I have no interest in the universe at all, actually. I have no interest in this world, no interest in the universe. I could absolutely care less about it. So, because I know it's completely useless to us, has no purpose whatsoever, no real purpose at all. It's just a completely arrogant, absurd exercise of futility, really, on our part. So, but there's all these people in the world now who are really eager, to study disempowerment more. So they've come into the world at a time when this hybridization program is taking place, so they can get into the new age of space exploration. Oh, gee, kids, we're going to go to Mars one day. Wow, that's amazing. What are we going to do on Mars? I don't know. We can measure, collect some dust. I don't know. What do you do on Mars? Look at the stars. Maybe. Hey, when we're on Mars, we can study the stars. Wow. Yeah. So these folks, you know, haven't got the memo yet. They haven't got the memo yet. But there's a ton of them in the world right now. So they are supporting this transitional time. It's a 10-year transitional time into the new age. Woo-hoo. And the hybridization program. And they can't wait to be part of that. We're giving birth to a new age, they call it. But really, they're giving birth to a new race. That's what they're really hyped up about. They're really hyped up about that. We're mothers to a new age and mothers to a new race. Wow, aren't we amazing? Aren't we amazing? Amazingly stupid. That's for sure. Amazingly uninformed, or as Buddha would put it, amazingly ignorant. Amazingly ignorant. I mean, how long can you stay in this ridiculous disempowerment dream? How long can we keep dreaming it? Before we start asking questions, say, wait a minute, you know, this doesn't seem like reality. What the heck? You know, is reality really dysfunctional, or are they just dreaming this? I mean, at some point, the light has to dawn, and you got to pay attention to it. And certainly, death is not an answer at all. Death doesn't do anything, doesn't cure us at all, doesn't cure us at all. It's just more false hope is all it is. More false hope, more disempowerment, same old, and then we find ourselves back with more dense form, you might say, identifying with dense form, because of course, in order to disempower anything, you have to have form. How can you disempower formlessness? I pure ideas. You can't. So to study disempowerment, we have to have form. And then we have to have forces, and forces have to act on form. And in the acting upon form, the form gets disempowered in various ways. And in order to disempower form, first you have to build it up. So we have forces that build up. We call those the good forces. And the forces that disempower, we call those the bad, evil forces, you know. But really, the tear-down forces, sure, we want to call those evil, disempowerment, forces of disempowerment. But the good forces are actually double evil. They're double evil because they're masquerading as not being part of this scheme of disempowerment. Oh no, we're just building up form. We're what do you call it? We're doing the good work. We're life affirming. We're building up form, but you're only doing it so that then the form can be disempowered. Absolutely a part of the whole scheme. That's part of one scheme, except it's masquerading like, oh no, we're the good. So the good is doubly bad. At least the bad is saying, yeah, you know, we're the bad guys. Right? But the good is saying, oh no, you're the bad guys, but we're really good. And then the bad guys say, no, that's not true. The good is doubly bad for lying about it and deceiving about it, like what's really going on. You can't have disempowerment unless you first bring about some form that's empowered in some way. And then the disempowerment, we give life, they call it, the empowered form, really. And then that empowered form gradually disintegrates in many different ways, is disempowered. So the good is doubly bad. So the really obstacle in getting free of this terrible dream, relinquishing it and accepting intrinsicness, is the good. It's the good that is the trickiest of all. They're really, really arrogant, and that the good is the good forces. We're the good forces. No, you're the double bad forces, actually. It's not that the bad forces are good, are fine. No, the bad forces tear down. But the good forces do the buildup and the seduction and say, look what we're doing. And oh, the bad forces came and there aren't, isn't that evil, isn't that terrible? No, the whole idea is evil and terrible, of trying to, you know, disempower reality. And the good is the ones that build up that which is then torn down. And they know exactly what they're doing. Those forces, it's our dream, of course, but in our dream, we know exactly what we're doing. So pretending to be good, Jesus said, why you call yourself good? He didn't like that term at all. He really jumped on that, says, no. You're not goody good. Don't call yourself good. You're double bad if you call yourself good. That kind of thing. So, and the meaning the play of forces in this dream. The good is willingly, knowingly building stuff up so it can be torn down. How bad is that? That's really bad. That's really bad. Of course, the bad says, hey, we need you to build up forces, build stuff up so we can tear it down. That's also true. Both are doubly bad, we'll say then. Yeah. But you get this holier than thou, you know, it's the goddess complex, holier than thou. That's the goddess complex that represents what we call the good. And the goddess complex is always thinking that they're better than the bad, so to speak. And they always say the more male aspect is, you do a lot of tearing down, but we do a lot of building up. As again, building up is double bad, because it's trying to claim some righteousness because of that, when the whole thing is just a scheme from the very beginning. So the toughest obstacle to overcome is the goddess complex. Everyone has to overcome that eventually. It's very difficult for people to overcome that. But we have to hear, you know, what's actually going on here. The goddess complex will gaslight you to the ultimate extent, making you think that she's holier than thou, she's so righteous, she's the one that builds up. How dare you, you know, suggest that this isn't, you know, wonderful, blah, 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 blah. And you have no right going beyond this, and you know this, and what are you doing? You must be evil if you don't believe in this and righteous, blah, blah, blah. And now we know, no, the goddess is double bad. So you say, well, I'm not bad. Yeah, that's right, you're double bad, is what you need to deal with the goddess. You say, the goddess is double bad. Agree with her, which is, I'm not bad, right? Yeah, right, you're double bad. That is for sure. So that's a big help in this turnover time, to hear that someone's actually saying this, because nobody's going to say this almost. They don't dare. You know, the goddess will gaslight them. And people are terrified of that. They're terrified. I don't blame them. I don't blame. It's not like I'm chewing anybody out. I know how difficult it is. I've been through it. It's nerve-wracking going through all this. And it's so, you know, but I'm just saying, you know, this is the dynamic that's going on here. And so the more you can hear this, the better it'll be for you, because you get familiar with it. And you say, oh, yeah, I'm getting familiar with that. It's not so scary. It's not as scary as it used to be, right? And you can say, well, the goddess isn't as scary as she used to be. That means you made huge, huge progress, essential progress. Sound like I look like I'm talking into the camera right here, isn't it? Wow. This is kind of cool. Nice lighting, sun. Yeah. So again, I'm not tearing into people. I'm just bringing shining light on the dynamic that of this dream and how tricky it is, and a different way of looking at it now. Don't be evil, but also recognize that good is double evil, so don't be that either. Be informed, drop your ignorance, accept what is intrinsic. Okay, that is what has to be done. You don't have to be good or evil, either one. Just accept what is intrinsic, which is reality. All reality is, it's intrinsic. It is not caused by any forces. There are no such thing as forces in reality. There's no such thing as a force causing a result in reality. There's no such thing as life forms in reality. There's no such thing as something that needs to breathe in reality. It needs to eat. It needs to this and that, otherwise it's going to die. There's no such scenario whatsoever in reality. The reality is formless. It's ideational. It's essence. It's essencing. It's essencing. It's just inging. It just is. It's just inging. It's essencing. It's ideing. Idea-ing. So there's nothing that can die. There's no forms that die. And there's nothing that can be disempowered in any way in reality. There is no such opportunity for disempowerment. Zero. Zero opportunity for disempowerment in reality. Zero. And that'll always be the case. So trying to be an expert at how to disempower is completely useless to us, utterly useless. And we'll have to relinquish it at some point. So why try to become better and better experts, you know, study more and more and more about this universe? Why? Nothing to see here. Nothing to see here. Nothing to see here. So this stuff is like, again, just get used to it. Just listen to it. Just hear it. Get used to it. Say, wow, this is interesting. This is wow. Just say, this is wow. This is the wow broadcast here. We're coming to you. The wow broadcast. This is a, yeah. It's a good time to tape right now where the sun is. Right? It's like blasting right in my face. Look at the cap there. We're coming to you live on the Wow Network. on the WOW Network. So what we need to do is ask for grace, the grace of the great perfection that knows that disempowerment is totally impossible, and we're just on this utterly useless, aimless quest, quixotic, arrogant quest, knows this, so is helping us be willing to relinquish it. Be willing to relinquish it. Call it the grace of the great perfection, if we like this, or the super compassion of the great perfection. Holy Spirit of God, you might, some say, would say, that is able to bring us to the point we can relinquish this absurdity, this quest, this absurdist quest. And so we need its help. We need its help. And so we can call upon its help. And we just say, just, you know, perfect immunity from all troubles. Just perfect immunity. Nothing can touch us. Perfect immunity. So just shocked by Ramana's perfect immunity in WOW. Just shocked by Ramana's perfect immunity in WOW. For instance, we can use that. We use that Ramana has acquitted himself extremely well in the world, so he certainly is worthy of us using him as an example. Just shocked by Ramana's perfect immunity and WOW. Just allowing Ramana's perfect immunity and WOW. Just accepting Ramana's perfect immunity and WOW. Just delighting in Ramana's perfect immunity and WOW. Just loving Ramana's perfect immunity in WOW, just abiding in Ramana's perfect immunity in WOW, just Ramana's perfect immunity in WOW, just Ramana's perfect immunity in WOW. Immunity from stupidity is what we need. So when we're talking about that, we're talking about immunity from all stupidity. That's what we need. That's what we need. We can't keep on trying to assess disempowerment as if there's something to gain from the assessment of it. The only thing to gain is that we don't need it. That it's not real. None of it's real. And intrinsicness is still real. That's what to gain from it, actually. That's what to gain from it. That's it. To gain from it is to drop it right here, right now. That's what we gain from it. So, obviously, our old friend is not the sharpest pencil in the box. Okay, not the sharpest pencil in the box. Otherwise, they would have relinquished this nonsense long ago. Long ago, long ago. The longer you hold on to this nonsense, the dumber you get. So hardly a very good role model for anyone, to say the least. Ramana Maharshi is a much better role model than, okay? Much, much better role model. So let's take Ramana as a role model. He's a fantastically great role model. Is not fooled by the goddess at all. Is not fooled by the goddess at all. Yeah, no, it knows how problematic that is. Is very aware of how problematic that is. The good, how problematic the good is, yeah. Doubly problematic, actually. Doubly problematic. Very, very aware of that. So just shocked by Ramana's perfect immunity in WOW, total immunity in WOW. Wow. Just shocked by Ramana's total immunity in WOW. Just allowing Ramana's total immunity in WOW. Just accepting Ramana's total immunity in WOW. Just delighting in Ramana's total immunity in WOW, just loving Ramana's total immunity in WOW, just abiding in Ramana's total immunity in WOW, just Ramana's total immunity in WOW, just Ramana's total immunity in WOW. So we need to get used to accepting total immunity in. Total immunity, even immunity from, okay, even immunity from that. Make sure that's included. Anything else would be uncivilized. So just loving Ramana's total immunity and WOW. Just loving Ramana's total immunity and WOW. Just loving Ramana's total immunity and WOW. Just loving Ramana's total immunity in WOW. It's funny. They're playing a golf PGA championship this week, and it's on the East Coast, it's on the Atlantic Ocean, and they raised the fairway so above the sand dunes so the wind would be hitting the golf course. I mean, it's very diabolical. Pete Dye designed the course. He should have been named Pete Diabolical, actually. Who would do that? Who would raise all the fairways on a seaside golf course just so the it would be constantly hit by the wind and make it like super treacherous and difficult? Who would do that? Well, you know who wanted to do that? You know who? Pete Dye's wife, Alice. Yeah, she told him, "Hey, Pete, you know, let's make it really diabolical. Raise the fairways." And he says, "Oh yeah, that's a good idea." It's his wife that came up with that idea. Interesting, huh? Very interesting. So they're playing there this week, and they're having troubles. It's really difficult. It's really difficult. But of course, being pros, some pros always going to shoot low. Some pros going to figure it out and do good, you know, right? I mean, you could have a pro playing on Mars and they would figure out a way to score. I mean, they're ridiculous. They really are. They really are. They're like freaks of nature, actually. That somehow they can adapt. This is the thing about the pros. There's always some pro that adapts no matter what circumstances there are. They figure out how to adapt to it. It's pretty impressive. Yeah. But, you know, it's called having a knack for something. That's what it is. So, you know, we'll see how it goes. We'll see if it gets real windy. Well, you're going to see some carnage there. For sure. Anyway. But the course is like the wind is swirling all different directions. They say you never could figure it out. They say it's diabolical. DeChambeau said the winds are diabolical here. It's just horrible. You say you're so mentally exhausted when you finish. You're just like you feel like you've been beaten up. It's just my God. Says every shot you just have to make a perfect adjustment. Even a 4 foot putt. He says the wind's blowing hard. You got to play a break. Suddenly the wind stops blowing. No break to the putt. It's just. He says you can't let up for a moment. He says it's like crazy, diabolical. Well, that's kind of like the times right now. I mean, if you let up for even a day right now, the whole world seems to have gone, you know, crazy. Just like what happened to you? Right. I feel like completely, you know, immersed in weirdness. I'm lost. That's how bad it is. We have to focus in on every single day and make at least a par every day. Sometimes birdie and occasionally like an eagle, like maybe like today. I think today was like an eagle day. Made some good shots. Made some good shots. Yes, indeed. And if you're a golfer, I have some advice, some quick advice. If at a par five, long par five, you're not going to reach it in two probably. You had a really good drive, but you still got like 250 something, you know, to get to the green, maybe more. Yeah, it's like, what do? You try to hit a three wood as hard as you can? No. Choke up on a three wood, which gives you a lot more control. It's a lot easier to hit a choked up three wood. And hit a choked up three wood, and the ball will go like 210 or something, or 220 or something. You know, choke up, it's so much easier to hit a choked up three wood, actually. You never see people doing that. Hit a choked up three wood, get it up there, and you're not into any trouble. You know, then you hit a full wedge on. Wedge on, don't let up on your wedges. Great bit of advice. You never hear that, but a choked up three wood's an incredibly important club to hit. Most of the time, you'll be hitting choked up three wood. And if you need a five wood off the tee, forget the five wood. Just choke up on a three wood and hit it off the tee. Okay? Yeah. You don't need a five. Trying to nuke a five wood is a dangerous shot. Trying to nuke any fairway wood is a dangerous shot. It's a super dangerous, low percentage shot. The pros can do it because they're the pros. Most people trying to nuke a fairway wood, they run into hideous trouble. Don't try to nuke it. Choke up on it a lot, and then just put a good, strong, nice, smooth swing on it, and accept the results. Accept the results. There you go. That's how to avoid trouble. Strategic. There's a good strategy right there. I'm going to listen to my own advice next time I hit a club, which may be, I don't know when. I can't seem to exert any upper body strength. It just kills me. You know, the exertion is what triggers this long haulers. It triggers it. If you just sit still in a chair, you feel okay. If you start doing anything, you know, exerting in any way, you feel horrible. It's a very scary scenario. But we're unraveling the layers of this, aren't we? So, how are we doing here? Pretty good. 54. I've been going like this all day long. Yeah, I've been feisty all day long. I've been on point all day long. It's not just in this video. I've been like this all day long, nonstop. On top of this situation, we have a developing situation in the world, to say the least. To say the least. And people simply are losing their minds. Everywhere I go and everyone I talk with, what I'm getting from them is indeed they're extremely troubled. Extremely troubled about something. Talk to someone who's a Taiwanese and I said, what about Taiwan? He said, no, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. I said, really? I said, the Chinese are amassing massive troops, massive this. He goes, no, don't worry about it. He says, the USA has technology that's 30 years ahead of the Chinese. 30 years ahead. So now you get some indication of why they didn't disclose. because what do the Chinese do? They steal technology, right? They steal technology. So they didn't want this technology stolen. So the best way to not have it stolen is don't even let anybody know that it exists. So, but that creates its own problems because they made deals. You know, they call it dealing with the devil. We get the technology and then you allow, you know, a lot of agreements are made along the hybridization program, etc. But anyway, that he said that the U.S. and its allies are way ahead of the Chinese in technology, and they actually can control, they can hack, they can remote control what's going on with a lot of the Chinese with their weaponry and all this kind of stuff. They can just deactivate it. They can do all sorts of things that the Chinese said. The Chinese aren't going to attack Taiwan. They said, we're not scared at all. Not scared about that at all. Interesting. He says, don't worry about it. Don't worry at all. He says, you have no idea what the technology is, what the U.S. has as far as technology. We don't even know. We're clueless about it. They don't tell us. We don't know. That's for sure. But it's likely they have quite a bit, to say the least. Then he's freaked out about the economy. He says, this economy, it's really weird. Really weird. And my thing is about the economy is whoever is keeping the economy up somehow, they could also bring it down. You see how that is? This is how I see it. Something is keeping the economy afloat. Somehow they're keeping it afloat. Because they want to keep it afloat. But if they decide they don't want to keep it afloat, this economy is just going to collapse. Kaboom. Whoever's keeping it afloat could also pull the plug on it. Could pull the plug on it. See, this is what we're saying. It's not intrinsically healthy, the economy at all, actually. He's talking about, you know, everyone I talk to in the supply chain, massive delays, massive back orders. It's a nightmare, global nightmare. I went into Trader Joe's today. They said, here, you want a bag? I said, sure. You got paper bags? He says, yeah. The only thing is we don't have handles on them. I said, what? He says, yeah, We can't get the glue to glue handles on the bags. They can't get the glue to glue handles on grocery bags. I said, well, yeah, you know, the glue, most of the glue comes from Texas. And the big freeze froze that area out, froze the glue. It froze the glue. They're having problems with all resin, glue, any sort of petroleum-based products because they refine the petroleum. Petroleum comes in the ports in Texas. They refine the petroleum into all sorts of industrial products. Okay, that stuff that got messed up when the electricity went off in Texas and the big freeze came. The combination of water pipes freezing, electricity being out, and the great freeze messed up all those products, and so they're not available. The plants are not, you know, maybe producing like they used to. I mean, you have a huge issue, supply chain throughout. The economy and the shipping problems throughout the world. The whole economy of the world, but in yet everything is just like stock market highest in history, greatest in history. I mean, who is propping that up actually? And whoever it is, however they're doing it, they could at some moment, maybe they have an agreement with somebody. They decide like, hey, no more. Time to pull the plug. So he was really, he's a very smart person, this Taiwan. He's very smart. And he's worried about the economy. He says the economy makes no sense at all. No sense at all. Why is it, you know, the way it is right now? He says, I have no clue. It's totally weird. Totally weird. And there's some indicators now coming up that are people are starting to say, uh-oh. But usually the worst crashes are the ones that happen the fastest. Okay, keep this in mind. The worst crashes are the ones that happen the fastest. And this crash, when it comes, is going to be the fastest crash in history. It's going to happen so fast, it's going to make everybody's head spin. Actually, make their head spin. They won't believe how fast it happens. That's why I say that people are, you know, if you want to sell your house now. Do it now. I've talked to a lot of people who either just sold or trying to sell their house, just sold it, getting ready to sell it, or trying to decide whether they should sell it or not. It's a ton of people. Wow, it's amazing how many. And one just already did it, and he's a real smart person, and he did it in time. And others are getting ready, almost ready to sell, and others are saying, you know, where would I leave? The thing is, I can't leave California. The weather's too good. This is the thing. We're weather addicts here. Truly, we are weather addicts here in California. We would look, people live here homeless. They'd rather live homeless in California than any place else. That's how much we love the weather here, actually. And I'm a weather addict too, of course. That's the problem. That's a problem. So everyone I talk to say, yeah, where would I go? Where would I go? I can't leave California. It's impossible. I don't, really, that's how Californians are. We are totally addicted to the weather here. Frightening addiction. I can't conceive of living anywhere else. Where? You know, where can I go that's like, well, yeah, I don't know, Greek island or something, or Mediterranean somewhere, you know, but it's not quite the same. It's not quite the same. There's nothing quite like it. The California weather is just like, kind of just blows you away, you know, just like you get up and you're the day, just how could the day be so nice? It's impossible. You know, it's kind of like that. It's just like in May, this May, you look at all the green foliage and everything, and everything just bursting with flowers everywhere, and you're just like, is this like real or a dream? You know, and the day's just sparkling and warm, just like, really? And so that's the problem with California. It's like nature at its finest, and it's like a little crumb, you know, it's a little crumb, like, we're holding on this little crumb as everything else is crumbling. So that's the issue with California. Where do you go? I gotta have, wherever it goes, we gotta have someplace better, you know, we're not gonna go someplace worse. You get completely spoiled, and you say, either it's better or nothing, basically. You don't want to go back to other conditions, actually. You know, it's just about here. We soak in the vibes. You know, we soak in the vibe where we are. That's what we do. We call it just vibing out in California. When we're driving, we're vibing, you know, basically. We're just, it's like, wow, just soaking in the vibe of the day. And it's, you know, if you get used to this, you can't just throw it away. You're used to it. You got it's in your DNA, so to speak. It's tough. Guys go down to Mexico, they come back and say, how hot was down there? I say, ah, real hot, real hot, real hot. I'm glad to be back. California weather, yeah. Why do you think all the Mexicans are up here? The weather. I mean, the jobs you have it, but the weather. They think, yeah, the weather's fantastic. Are you kidding me? It's broiling hot down in the Mexico, a lot of areas. They don't want to leave. Why do I want to leave? Why do I want to leave here? You know, nobody wants to leave, except that's the problem. Everybody's too many people are here, and it's getting too expensive. And of course, all the money wants to be here, and so it's like a scary situation, very scary. That's like maybe the scariest thing of all. That is even more scary than if I have to leave California. That's absolutely terrifying. Absolutely terrifying. It's like, should I die or should I leave California? Like, that's a tough question. Really. I just feel like I just mope. You know, just like, are you kidding me? This weather, it's horrible. I can't stand this. Are you supposed to be happy with this? No, no way. This is terrible. Maybe go to Hawaii. Maybe live in Hawaii. That's about the only alternative there is, right? Live in Hawaii. Yeah. A lot of people here have houses in Hawaii. Yeah, they do. They do. And they just go back and forth. Come back to California. Ah, just in Hawaii. And then when things get bad here, let's go to Hawaii for a month. That kind of thing. But they are weather addicts. Those are true weather addicts. And it's not such a good thing to be a weather addict, actually. Yeah. It's a dangerous thing. It's a very dangerous thing. Very, very dangerous thing, actually. We're trying to just get some vibe of perfection, you know? Can we get some vibe of perfection? Can we get some vibe of perfection somehow, some way? And we just want it to be an ambient perfection, because that's reality. Everything is perfect. It's the complete ambience. It's just a total ambience. So feeling this weather ambience gives us some faint reminder of reality. It does. It's a faint reminder, like, yeah, it's just, I feel like everything is just so wonderful. It's just, wow, the light with May is fantastic. The light, because there's a lot of light. It's going towards the longest day of the year. We're closing in on that, only about a month away from that. So we get this like 2 month window of just a ton of light and the greenery of May and June, right? And the flowers and everything. It's like a drug. It really is like a very strong drug where you just feel like, wow, maybe disempowerment's not that bad. Or at least I found some way to drug myself so it's not feel so it doesn't feel hideous, that kind of thing. And we're afraid if we don't have this drug, we're going to feel hideous. Well, those people in other places have found other drugs such as alcohol and et cetera to not feel so hideous. Here, the idea of alcohol doesn't really occur so much. People like to sip some wine maybe to enhance the thing, but you want to feel the drug, just go outside, look at the flowers, check out the light, the ambience and everything here, and just take a walk through the neighborhood. It's just like, wow, it's beautiful. It's like so beautiful. Walking through neighborhoods here is just mind-blowing right now. The roses are just, like knocking you out. Every house has just got knockout stuff. I just say, wow. And it's so balmy and beautiful and dry. It's not humid. There's no humidity in California at all. You're not sweating. It's just too much. It's too much. Too much good stuff. So that kind of masks a little bit of the torture of this dream. Whereas other places, they have other ways of masking the torture of the dream. They have other ways. Just a lot of silliness. Let's do some silly stuff together. Right, let's go bowling. All right, that's a bunch of indoor stuff they do, like in the Midwest, and they do indoors. They have all these big, huge indoor venues and stuff where people go do stuff. We're saying like, what? What? Indoors, doing stuff indoors? What's that? We go outdoors. We take a walk through the neighborhood or something like that, yeah, the hills or wherever. We don't go indoors to do something here, but they have all this big warehouses and indoor stuff. I have no idea what indoor stuff is. No, I'm completely clueless about how, what could you possibly do indoors? I don't know. But they can do it year round, right? It snows, it's okay. We got a big indoor event here. That's why they love their like basketball, high school basketball, that kind of thing. All sorts of different stuff. I don't even know what it is, but auctions. Somehow they keep occupied, right? When it's sweltering, super hot, humidity, and things like that. They're somewhere in air conditioned, somewhere doing something they want, enjoy doing, or something like that. So it's a really different lifestyle here. It's super different. Super. There's not a single day of the year that feels unpleasant here, actually. Especially in drought years. There's not like a single day that feels unpleasant, you could say. It used to be everybody's just wandering around here, just drugged out on the atmosphere, and so, oh, I feel so pleasant here. Is it? Hey, it's very pleasant. How do you feel? I feel very. It's a very pleasant day, isn't it? Oh, yes, it is. That's how it used to be back in the 60s. Everybody's just like, wow, this is pleasant. Say, hey, how are you today? Says, like, nice weather, huh? They say, great weather. And basically saying, hey, really nice drug, huh? Yeah, great drug. I found the best drugs. It's in California. The weather. It's the best drug in the world, but not good enough. Not good enough. Didn't work for me. You develop tolerance to it. You develop tolerance to it. Then you need better and better and better and better and better weather, actually. And then you start getting real like agitated. I used to get super agitated when there's like rain or storm or anything. I used to go into a depression. I get so agitated. I couldn't stand it. And like the winter, I just would mope throughout the winter. I just like, I can't stand this. Hate it. Because as you become, you're so addicted to perfect weather that if it's not, real, if it's just off a little bit, the tolerance, you develop tolerance and you demand like, the best day of the year every day. Otherwise, you get furious. So that's a big problem here. I really had that bad. I used to wear a t-shirt and shorts all year long. I refused to cave into the to if there's any bad weather, cold. I said, nah, tomorrow will be perfect. So I wore a t-shirt and shorts all year round and sandals all year round. A lot of people still do that here. You see, in the wintertime, they're wearing shorts and sandals and t-shirts. Yeah, they're not caving into the weather. They say, nah, just wait a couple hours. It'll be great. Tomorrow will be a fabulous day. And in drought years, that's true. In drought years, you get a few days that are a little bit cool or whatever, but then you look at the weather forecast and it's like, oh, look at that. We've got some high 70s coming in. It's January, but you got high 70s coming in, even hit 80, that kind of thing. So, and you live by the coast, it's more moderate there. It doesn't get as cold by the coast. You live down in Southern California, Santa Monica. It's like it rarely goes below 70 ever, that kind of thing. So, of course, t-shirts and shorts all year. Major, major drug. So what do you do if you have to go somewhere else in the world? Well, I've been working on it my whole life. You got to have a portable paradise with you. You got to carry your own atmosphere with you. Is that possible? I hope it is. I've been working on it my whole life. I haven't got it yet, but I believe it is possible because certain great spiritual coaches had that. They called it a portable paradise. Wherever they went, the ambience of the whole area just felt perfect. This perfect ambience feeling. It wasn't a weather thing, it was an ambience thing. But what is the weather except very poor ambience? So, it's a force-based ambience. But the spiritual coaches carry a non-force-based ambience. It's not based on results, it's an intrinsicness. They carry this ambience of intrinsicness, which is perfection. And people feel that even more than they feel the California weather. So the only thing that's better in California weather is intrinsicness, those in the world who have accepted intrinsicness. That's the only thing that's better than California weather. So I have to get that. Otherwise, I'm doomed. Doomed. Totally doomed. That's how I feel. I feel if I have to move out of California, which looks like that likely it would happen, my circumstances are such that on very thin ice, I would feel totally doomed unless I had intrinsicness. If I have intrinsicness, then everything would feel would be just, I would be feeling intrinsicness continuously. And no results would be necessary from the universe. I wouldn't need results from the universe. So it wouldn't even be a weather situation at all, actually. It's like, does a shadow affect the thing that's casting this shadow? No. There's a tree that's scared of its shadow. So it says, look at that shadow on the ground. That's going to cause me great troubles. No. So does a dream of disempowerment affect intrinsicness in any way? Not in any way. Not in any way. So when we see the sun up, sun out, everything's casting shadows. Are those shadows causative? Like they're going to harm the things that are casting the shadows? Are the buildings are casting the shadows? Is the shadow going to demolish, you know, the building? What power does a shadow have over things, actually? So this whole dream of disempowerment can be likened like a shadow. It doesn't have any power over reality. So yeah, how we doing? Pretty good here. And we'll see if we can get this video up. They might not like us talking about, you know, so much. Yeah, but we didn't let any cats out of the bag, really. And, you know, we understand why they kept it quiet, because the Cold War, they didn't want espionage to take place. The less people knew about it, the easier it is to keep it secret. And they saw that the future of power in this world is technology. So it's been a technology race going on in the world. And that's where the power really is. And so they wanted to make sure that the least number of people possible knew about what was going on. That's why they kept it all covered up. And we're not spilling any secrets, specific secrets at all at this time. All this stuff has come out before. I don't know what the technology is. I don't know where it is. I don't know any of that stuff. And most people don't either. This, who knows, right? So hopefully this video will pass muster. But we're focused on being protected from the social engineering and the possible population that may very well be part of this scenario going forward. Because they want a hybrid race on this planet. That they don't want humans on the planet anymore unless they're slaves. Slave class. But it'll be a slave class of humans, but it'll be lowered down to like a beast-like level, and then there'll be the hybrids, and the slave class will do all the stuff that, you know, the hybrids don't want to get their hands dirty doing that stuff. That's actually the future of this world. I was shown the future of this world by the Avatara, Anandamayi Ma, and I said, what the heck is going on here? Wow. And yeah. Interesting. So that's the situation. If you're willing to be a slave, then you might make it into the new age. And if you're willing to be a hybrid, part of that hybrid, supporting that whole situation, you might make it into the new age. But if you don't want to do one of those two roles, you might not make it into the new age, actually. So we need a another option, don't we? We need options right now. We need options. So we're calling on the great spiritual coaches to present your options. Let's have cards on the table at this point and find out what our options really are. And just accept perfect immunity, Ing. Wow, just perfect immunity, Ing. So it's a very interesting time in history. And if you are making mistakes, if you are being distracted, give yourself a pass. Give yourself a pass. That's okay. I'm making mistakes, little mistakes, just trivial stuff, but stuff I ordinarily wouldn't make mistakes because my mind is on all these big issues. So the little trivial stuff, maybe I'm not, you know, oops, I made a little mistake there. And people who like to try to boost themselves up by catching trivial mistakes, stuff, they say, ah, you did, look at that, you did, you must be stupid. No, it's because I've got my mind on really important stuff. And so if you make trivial mistakes, it's because you're in the game and you're paying attention to what's really important. So just give yourself a pass on all that stuff. That's very, very okay to do, better than okay. So every day again is another layer of what's going on. And the real command and control situation in the world is probably quite different than we realize. And we'll continue, things will continue to get weirder and weirder and weirder if you don't know what's going on. If you do know what's going on, you'll just say, it's just business as usual. It's not a surprise at all, actually. And that helps us in our reaction, staying nice and calm, nice and cool, stay on point, stay focused, work on accepting perfect immunity, perfect protectioning, just accepting perfect protectioning. Wow. Right here, right now, just accepting perfect protectioning. Wow. Right here, right now, accepting Ramana's perfect protectioning. Wow. Right here, right now, just accepting Ramana's perfect protectioning. Wow. Right here, right now, just Ramana's perfect protectioning. Wow. Right here, right now, just Ramana's perfect protectioning. Wow. Now, anybody can do this. Anybody can do it. We're open source here. So even the can do it. They can do it too. They're welcome to do it. I'm happy to do it. My desire for everyone is to spend the least amount of time with this delusional dream of disempowerment. Spend the least amount of time with that. Get free as soon as possible. That is what I truly desire and will for everyone. For everyone, without any exception. We don't want anybody spending more time we want them to spend the least amount of time possible in this stupid dream of disempowerment. So that's my perspective. That's how I view it all. So anybody and everybody, get out as fast as you can. Relinquish, accept intrinsicness as fast as we can here. Everyone. That's the only way you do anyone any favors. Because clinging to this is not doing any favors to anyone. That's for sure. Yeah, okay. I got to get some food for somebody. Gee. So what a video this has been, huh? And you might be shocked to say, wow, just like kaboom. But this is just normal stuff for right now. I mean, we are in these times, so you just got to keep the pace. We're picking up the pace here. We're picking up the pace. We're picking up the pace. So just, you know, catch your wind. Get your wind. You'll get your wind. What's your wind? Familiarity is your wind. Familiarity wins also. Okay, because that enables us to then go even better pace, even greater pace, and outpace the situation. Outpace the situation that's going on here. Outpace it. Very great. Wow it. My past is wow. My present is wow. My future is wow. How I fixed reality is wow. They're all results are ultimately wow. All is everything. Encapsulate all delusion is simply wow. Okay, it's simple. Okay, encapsulate all delusion. All delusion is simply wow, 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 wow,